call the meeting to order, please. Work session Tuesday, April 26, 2011. Second agenda item is citizen comments, where citizens have an opportunity to comment about things that are not on the agenda. So is there anyone who would like to make comments? Seeing none, we'll move on to number 3, 4, and 5. Three permit applications. Is there any questions about any of those? Anybody has? Okay. We'll move on to item number 6, presentation on stream name revisions. Where's Crystal?
I think it's Crystal's turn.
Here's Crystal.
Come on up.
Look mighty snappy.
Yeah, she does.
Yeah, she's Thank got you. Some sparkle going on.
And who are we naming the streams after?
All of them. Well,
all
we
each yeah, and all of them.
Some catchy names,
Jack,
I'm sure.
Your favorite.
Jack the dog.
Maybe I hate to say this, but you can't name streams after any person until they've been deceased for at least 5 years. So maybe you don't want it named after you.
No, we don't want that. Yeah.
Move on with your presentation then.
What about a bridge?
You can after a bridge.
Skip the stream, go to the bridge.
Okay. Eric, are you ready? Okay.
We got a video here.
There you go.
Time for I'll let Eric flip slides for me. I'll just tell him when to change it. Oh, okay.
Are you going to point or anything?
We didn't think you'd get to number 6 so quick today.
I know.
It was impressive.
We figured it would be quick, but not that quick. Okay, so... city staff want to move forward with clarifying some of the stream names inside the city limits of Franklin, and also renaming some streams that have inconsistencies, and looking at formally naming streams that are currently unnamed. The slide on the screen right now shows kind of what I'm talking about. We have three different GIS layers that staff currently uses to identify streams within the city limits of Franklin. Those three GIS layers come from the USGS, the state of Tennessee, and Williamson County. The Williamson County stream layer is shown in pink, the state of Tennessee stream layer is shown in green, and the USGS stream layer is shown in blue. And as you can tell just by looking at the overlay of where each one of those databases say those streams are, there's inconsistencies there. And beyond that, there's inconsistencies in the naming. If you look in the center of the screen, take that stream for instance. The USGS calls it North Ewingville Creek. That's what flows through Pinkerton Park and just north of Highway 96 over across Eddy Lane, that area. The state has that as an unnamed stream, and the county calls it Ralston Branch. And internally, the city has been calling this Ralston Creek. So we want to go forward with a process to remove that inconsistency. There are also other inconsistencies with other creeks besides just the Ralston Creek. South Ewingville Creek, which runs south of Highway 96, is also known as an unnamed stream by the state of Tennessee and by Williamson County. The USGS calls that South Ewingville Creek, and we'd like to remove the south connotation and just call that Ewingville Creek. So we would have, instead of North and South Ewingville, we would have a Ralston Creek and then a South and then a Ewingville Creek. The next creek where there is an inconsistency in names is Sharps Branch. It is called Sharps Branch by city staff and the USGS and by Williamson County. However, the state of Tennessee names that Sparks Creek. So we have some inconsistencies there. So these are just recommendations, but this is just to get you aware of some of the inconsistencies we have with staff. So it becomes very difficult as we're talking to other agencies to really know what we are talking about. If I'm talking to somebody from TDEC and say Sharps Branch, they may not know what creek I'm talking about. And this slide shows all of the unnamed streams inside the corporate limits of Franklin. Each stream that's highlighted in green is an unnamed stream, and there are roughly 30 of those. Most of those are either in the Five Mile Creek watershed or in the area near West Haven, which city staff currently calls the Hatcher Spring area. So we would like to go forward with a process to formally name all those streams. So how are we actually going to go forward with naming those streams? Well, you submit an application to the U.S. Board of Geographic Names, which is a sub-board of the U.S. Geological Survey. This board has the role of settling conflicts between agencies, which we've seen with the North Ewingville Creek and South Ewingville Creek and Sharps Branch area. Also, it determines the official names of any geographic feature, not just streams itself. They are charged with approving name changes. They're more likely to conform to a local usage name. So if it was something that the City of Franklin staff members currently called and the citizens of Franklin currently called it that, they would bear towards that name instead of the name that's actually on the USGS maps. They also remove any derogatory names and to eliminate duplicate names.
Like what?
Yeah. we cannot answer that question. Yeah.
Do not answer that. Stinky Creek.
And then the next role that they have is to actually approve applications to name the unnamed features. So they have a long list of guidelines to what you can and cannot use to name a feature. We kind of discussed that while we're waiting on the presentation to be loaded. But commemorative names or nicknames of deceased persons are highly recommended. Names already established among local deceased citizens.
I think that's a typo.
Yeah.
I meant this.
Spell check
didn't catch that. I'm sorry. I apologize.
Spell check to be deceased.
And then, yeah. And then the descriptive names from local history. You know, Franklin has a huge historical influence from the Civil War era. So typical things like that can be used to go forward with the naming process. And then once we go through that, we need to actually submit an application to the board. Then they all consult with state and local organizations. Of course, we as the local organization are submitting the application, so it looks better for actually the local authority to go forward with that instead of a common citizen, but common citizens can also go through this process. And then they make a decision within 3 to 6 months. If it is a application that has a lot of public support behind it, it can be expedited up to a 30-day process. So we can know within 30 days whether our recommendations have been approved or not. And then an approval letter is mailed to the applicant. So moving forward, city staff would like to open up a public hearing process to gain public support and get their input on these stream name changes so we can go forward with kind of removing those inconsistencies and be clear between city staff and outside agencies and the public citizens of Franklin to know what water bodies we're talking about. So at that time, I'll answer any questions that you have.
What an enjoyable presentation.
have we heard any local, you know, people who live in an area, has anybody been contacted to say, is there a common name that those people may have used that maybe we, as even the city staff, wouldn't know?
Yeah, not at this point. That's what we hope to open the door to be able to do. Yeah.
So there's 30 possible names that we need to be developed?
Yes.
We could name them after the former town characters.
Mm-hmm.
no diseased people.
I don't know what they were now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, character areas is a good way to start. This is obviously going to involve a lot of staff from historic preservation and planning as well as engineering and opening that up to the public to try to get input. So city staff would like to be able to move forward with coming up with some names through talking to people and doing historical research and then getting public input. I think that would probably be a more fluid process.
You said they have to be dead 5 years.
That's what the USGS recommends. Yes.
I think that's an excellent approach.
It says recommends.
We can work that out.
I think they're flexible.
Four years, 3 months, and stuff like that.
Time you get through their process.
Work with us a little bit, especially if there's a good deal of support.
That's great. They really just frown upon having any living person have a stream named after them. So it's not as commemorative that way.
Well, I mean, I want a creek named after me, but not that bad.
He's gone on record. Okay.
All right. Any other questions?
I think their approach they want to take is wonderful. Just move forward with that.
You'll hear more from us.
More coming.
It'll be a couple months or so.
Margaret will come up with some names.
Be a fun
appreciate process. Your input.
Clyde and Margaret. Sure.
Yeah.
Historical sounds good.
They're all historical.
Okay. Thank y'all.
Thank you.
Thank
great
you.
Presentation. I think we'll take number 7 and 8 together because if that's okay. Consideration utility relocation contract with the Tennessee Department of Transportation for Franklin Water Main and also for Franklin Sanitary Sewer Main. For the Mack Hatcher Parkway Extension Northwest Quadrant, Mr. Parker.
Well, this is a standard TDOT contract for the utility relocations. We do have water and sanitary sewer lines that are affected by the Mack Hatcher Extension. We have received this, and we just need to go forward. I have asked for it to be on this agenda, plus the next meeting for voting, because we are on a tight time frame. They didn't get us the contract till just recently, and we're supposed to have plans completed by June 15th. So at your next meeting, we'll be coming to you with a consultant to get those plans done. But anyway, that's where we are. So that's what these are. Shauna has reviewed these. Mrs. Billingsley has reviewed these. Signing off on them, so just want to go forward with it.
Can you maybe comment, does it have any effect on reducing the cost of Hillsborough Road? Does it get us more money for any of those projects?
What we have in the contract is estimated cost for some of the relocations. We are working with TDOT trying to get a little bit of extension for the waterline along Hillsborough Road. But whatever we get for waterline relocation along Hillsborough Road is a positive that we would have been paying ourselves completely. Some of the sewer is the same situation along Hillsborough Road, that we have some relocations on sanitary sewer, that any of that would be a part of this contract is a positive for us, and it reduces our overall cost for the Hillsborough Road project once we get to that point.
So we would have had some relocation costs.
We have,
regardless,
and
this agreement provides a little bit of TDOT support.
We have contracts already in place for some design for the water and sewer on Hillsborough Road, but this with the Mack Hatcher, we have to change some of that. So, but it is something that we're trying to get worked out. But it is a positive effect for the city anyway. It cost us less money for that project.
Okay, go ahead, Mark.
Do we have any ideas, estimates of how much more it'll be over TDOT?
No, not until we get a design or get an agreement with TDOT of how far we can go. We're trying to do the water line all the way down to the high school, plus the sanitary sewer all the way down to the high school, make a logical tie-in spot. So we do not know. That was not contemplated at the front end of when we submitted way back in the summer about relocations. The other issue that we're working with TDOT on is we're trying to get them to basically allow us to do Hillsborough Road relocations as a project under us before Mack Hatcher starts. And then anything else on Mack Hatcher, put it in their contract where their contractor would do the relocations. But the Hillsborough Road, we know we have to do, whether Mack Hatcher goes first or whether Hillsborough Road goes first, and we need to get in there and get out of the way prior to either one of those projects. So we're trying to get that set up, but we don't know that yet. So, but we don't have a cost at this point.
I mean, will it be as much as these are?
It'll be more.
Yeah, I mean,
the other issue is typically TDOT will reimburse you for replacing a particular line size. We have a 12-inch line in Hillsborough Road where we're going to redo it as an 18-inch line, but we also have to do some paralleling on the other side from where we put the 18 with 6 or 8-inch lines to be able to serve everybody. The storm drainage and everything in Hillsborough Road prevents us from just crossing the road with services and all, which, so it's, we have to do some paralleling. So it's something we got to get worked out, but it will be more.
Ideally, we would love to have those numbers for you, and we just don't because we're not far enough along in design. But the bottom line is those were costs we were going to have to absorb anyway.
Right.
In the Hillsborough project in particular, and at least we're getting $100,000 on the water side and $300,000 on the sewer side to help go towards that from TDOT. So it's a net benefit to us overall. The full cost that we'll anticipate, we'll know that when we're further along in design.
Just a question. Which side is the 18-inch going to be on? Is it going to be on the
west?
Okay.
It's going to be on the west for a ways, and then it's going to cross and go to the east.
Well, I was going to say the high school side or the other side, but the west most of the time.
As far as the Mac Catcher project, it's on the west side of Hillsborough Road, but we cross, and then on the Hillsborough Road project, it's actually going to be under pavement, right where the bike lane is.
Okay.
On the east side.
On the east side. Okay.
Do you have a question?
Okay. I was just reading here. So what you're saying is the estimates that TDOT gives us is not allowable enough to put in the size of the main that we really need?
The estimate that we have from TDOT was something that we produced back July when we submitted, and then we've been waiting for July until now to get the contract to do the work. That estimate only, as far as anything on Hillsborough Road, just looked right there at the intersection. That was it. Just some small relocations right at the intersection itself. Mac Catcher project actually goes up Hillsborough Road to Claude Yates Drive. As far as the project itself to tie in. So, and we're having the same situation with the electrical and telephone and all as far as getting it worked out, because at one point everybody thought the Hillsborough Road would be first. Now it looks like MacArthur's going to be first. So it's a shifting of trying to get things handled. So.
But what you're saying is they still don't allow enough for reimbursement.
Well, typically they do not allow for upsizing your line when they pay for a relocation. Typically. We don't know what they're going to allow for us as far as cost at this point until we get the design done, get the plans to them for approval. But typically they do not – you have to pay any cost difference for upsizing, typically.
And we have to upsize? I mean, is that going to be necessary?
It would
the plans have always been to upsize because we do have the problems of transmission of water in the downtown area, the west side, et cetera.
Yeah, right.
And so we put an 18-inch line in Columbia Avenue. So this will be basically connecting from a 20 or 24-inch line to the 18 we've already put in.
Yeah, okay. Got it.
As an 18.
Yeah, makes sense.
Okay, moving on. Number 9, consideration of sole source purchase from Q's Incorporated of Orlando, Florida, in the total amount of $36,156 for parts, supplies, training, support, and labor necessary to license and install and upgrade the Granite XP data acquisition system for the wastewater collection system of the Water Management Department. Is that just a TV truck?
I didn't write that.
Yeah.
It's actually the wastewater collection division, uses a closed circuit television camera to inspect sanitary sewers. This is an upgrade to the software, which we've had for excess of 8-9 years. The new software will tie into Hanson, including the Hanson 8 version that we're moving towards. Also our geographic information system, and allow us to better document defects or anything of that nature with our pipes when we go through our condition assessments. So request that we move this forward.
We've had that for 8 years.
Yes, ma'am.
Questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on, number 10, discussion of extending the sunset date for the retiree health insurance to September the 30th.
We'll try to get Shirley up here.
It's like a maze.
Good evening. This is a request due to the lateness of us getting our consultants approved. We did not have time. We do not have time to really analyze and look at what we need to do and get the best practices for the employee insurance. And we
sorry
would,
about that.
Or the that's retiree right. insurance. But we would like to extend it until the end of September, 3 months. We've done the research. The people with 30 years experience and that are eligible for the retiree coverage, there will be no additional people from now until September 30th. The people with 25 years, there are three people that will be eligible after June 30th, but two of those people have already talked to me about retiring this year, so it should not impact us either way.
It gives us a little more time to look at this. This issue is sort of a sub-point to the work we've done on the pension, where we've got multiple different programs out there. There was a sunset established for the end of June 2011. We just extend that out a few months to give us a little more time to work through those options, maybe work with probably the Budget and Finance Committee first as a work group, and then bring it to the full board in terms of what some options might be, and ultimately with the desire of getting us to a program that's going to work for us over the long haul. And this is one we've kind of changed, sort of like we changed the pension a few different times, and we'd like to get to a place that we think is sustainable, provides the right level of support, fits with our overall management of the costs associated with benefits, and gets us to the place we need to be to make a good decision. So I look at it as sort of a smaller version of the work we did on pension, where we need to provide the right level benefit at an affordable cost, but is also still meaningful to the employees that are impacted.
Thank you, Shirley. Number 11, discussion on the fiscal year 2011 to 2015 CIP prioritization. We're going to actually have a number of presentations, and what I would like to do is let everybody make their presentations that are going to make them, so there's good flow of thought on their part and on our thought part as we listen, and jot your questions down that you may have, and after the presentation's over, then we will go through the question and answer. So
we've got a handout we're providing you to that provides some more specifics. Some of it is already in what was in your packet, but it also provides some additional information. We're fortunate in that the way the work session schedule worked out, we've got a good chunk of time now to have some discussion. And last time the board had directed us to maybe do a special work session, but we thought this window gives us an opportunity to at least get started. What we'd like to do tonight is take you through the existing funding plan, and specifically those projects that are yet to be bid, and what those projects are, to sort of refresh your memory on the elements of what those projects are, as well as where we are with those at this point, and then take you through what also has been completed in that, and then take you through what's recommended by staff at this point in terms of a capital investment project package, and then at the end of that also give you an overview of that funding plan that was approved about a year and a half ago, and where we stand compared to that overall, and what kind of capacity is available compared to what the board committed to back then, and how that fits in as well, and then have further discussion from there about any issues you want us to cover. So I'll let David take it away, and we'll present this to you, and then take questions at the end.
Before you do that, just clarify one thing for me. When you go over these, they're not set in any certain way as far as priorities within this board, is it?
They are.
This is your funding plan.
This is your funding plan.
It's first page.
That is. The first page is.
Wait a minute.
We've already approved.
We don't have that.
Oh, you don't?
No.
We do not.
Do you have this?
No.
We have this, but we don't have that. This is the page. We have that, but ours doesn't have this.
It's on the back. It's on the
My first page is a map of Hillsborough Road.
Okay. That's the third page.
Yeah, this page here is missing from them.
On the back?
So some of them have it and some of them don't have it.
Those with good memories don't have it.
Can we run some?
Hey, no, you're wrong about that.
We use two copy machines.
This is the one they're missing.
Finish it up.
I don't have it.
It's the back of the front page.
All right, we share this.
Maybe run five more two-sided?
So what you're saying?
Oh, wait, are they two-sided on everything? Are we missing half of it?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
The whole thing's two-sided.
Oh. Wait, come out.
You all got them?
You have to remember.
Every other.
Mine's two-sided. It's two-sided.
We're as green a community as we can be, so it's two-sided.
So is it by project or by?
I'll explain.
I need to clarify.
That's the group that you funded.
Right.
So, yeah, it's just.
Do you need to wait till you have them in hand, or you can go ahead?
Can we share so we can move on? Yeah.
We. Okay. Well, we'll go on. The first page.
Easy rider.
The first page is the funding that we've already had approved. It was included in what we sent to you in a packet for a month or so ago, considering the CIP. On that first page, you'll notice that Matt Hatcher, which is the overall number one priority from everybody, is the very top page, at 17 million plus committed or spent to date. That represents what the city has used for design of the project. It represents what we have funded, the 5 million we funded for right away and completion of design. It represents 12 million plus that the state has committed to right away itself. So that's what makes up that 17. You see it spread out starting at fiscal year 2013 for construction. That is being pushed up. We're being told that they're going to try to fund Matt Hatcher construction in next year's budget, which would be approved in July, but you can't spend any money until October, which means that we would have a bid letting in December. So that is the schedule right now for Matt Hatcher construction. That is the reason when we were looking at those contracts a few minutes ago that we're on a very tight time frame with the utility relocations. But all of the construction is TDOT funded. We have no more, City of Franklin has no more responsibility for funding. We have spent everything that has been approved to be spent, and we should be getting reimbursements for some of the right-of-ways activities as we speak now anyway. So that's where we are on Matt Hatcher, number one, overall number one priority for the City of Franklin. Now, in your funding plan that was approved in Resolution 2009-44, we had the four projects. You had Hillsborough Road, number one priority, McEwen Drive, number two. Then you had, or was it Columbia Avenue, number two, and then McEwen Drive, whichever.
Yeah.
We did not list Columbia Avenue here because it's done.
Thank you.
So it's not listed in this. We're at the point of Columbia Avenue of just trying to finish it up and get a final change order to rectify all cost and close that project out. So that's where we are with Columbia Avenue, but it was in the funding plan. Third Avenue is the...
Let me comment on that real quick. At the end, you'll see, we'll go through the funding plan and show you some numbers, how those numbers came out versus what was in that funding plan kind of thing. So you'll see Columbia in that perspective.
Right. Third Avenue is that it was that priority five, or in some cases, or six, as we have listed in some cases. We're not sure exactly how the numbering, but that's what was included in the scenario seven that was approved in the funding plan. The next, what's in blue, was projects that were approved July 13th by resolution. This is your small capital projects. Nickel Mill's not a small capital, as we've been pointed out, but it was approved and it was being used. Some of the savings that we had done is what we were looking at as far as funding that project. As you're well aware, Nickel Mill is under construction. Mallory Station Road, General George Patton Drive, signalization has been approved. It is under construction. And then we have the Eastern Flank Battlefield Access Roadway, which is on hold. There was $369,000 approved for that, but we're trying to work out what needs to be done and how we're going to go forward with that. And that's working with Battlefield Commission. Mm-hmm. Battlefield Commission. And then you'll recall also that in green down here was approved with an agreement with Williamson County School Board for the intersection of McEwen Drive and Wilson Pike. And that was where the school board would be has committed $1 million. The city of Franklin has committed $1 million of the special facilities tax collections that that has taken place, I guess, when that went up in what the costs were. So that project is, we're trying to get the design completed and be ready to go to construction as soon as we can. Next slide, we wanted to go over the two big projects that are sort of out there pending right now, which is Hillsborough Road and Third Avenue. So the next project is a map of the Hillsborough Road project, and we'll kind of go through it. That you see in blue is the Hillsborough Road Improvements Project. It is a separate contract with TDOT. That in red is the Claude Yates Intersection Improvement Project. That is a separate contract with TDOT that we've entered into. The TDOT, or the contract numbers, are listed in the description. If you recall, we finally got those squared away about 2 or 3 months ago, I guess, for final approval on the various contract. Green is the MacCatcher Extension Project. You'll notice that the Hillsborough Road, Claude Yates Intersection Improvement and MacCatcher sort of overlap. And that's where we had the discussion before concerning the lanage that would be at MacCatcher between Claude Yates and MacCatcher Drive. As I explained in a meeting, I think the last meeting when we talked about any of this, the MacCatcher Parkway project has 7 lanes at the intersection on Hillsborough Road. What the board, this board, or maybe a previous, the just previous board, I can't remember if everybody here was on the board at the time, had discussed whether or not we were going to have 5 lanes or 7 lanes. You wanted only 5 lanes. That is what we were doing when it was going to be the Hillsborough Road project first, and then MacCatcher would come in and change that. Well, now MacCatcher is going to be first, so it'll be 7 lanes to begin with. We will tie the Claude Yates Intersection project in with those 7 lanes. It will be transitioned back. It will be 3 lanes. The blue portion of the project
it's
is
going to be 7 lanes down to Claude Yates?
No.
Not quite. It will be 7 lanes at the intersection, and then it will start transitioning back, and by the time you get to Claude Yates, it will be a 3-lane section. So at Claude Yates, there will be 3 lanes. From Claude Yates up to where, basically where you see the 431 designation for Hillsborough Road, federal or state route or federal route, that is going to be a 3-lane section, except in front of the high school will be a 4th lane across the frontage of the high school for a right turn lane, which will be on the high school side. It'll be a right turn lane from Joel Cheek Boulevard, basically from Joel Cheek Boulevard up to Claude Yates Drive. And that gives you some stacking abilities, et cetera, for the right turns into the high school and Columbia State College. And then the rest of the project is a 4-lane. It is not divided or anything. It is
3-lane.
Going back towards 96.
Going back toward 96 is 4 lanes. I'm sorry. Okay. From the commercial area, which is round Wendy's, back toward 96. Well, there is a transition from the 3 to the 4. But then commercial area back to 96 is a 4-lane roadway. Also along this whole stretch will be bike lanes. And then we have the elements of the streetscape that will be part of the project also. And that will...
How wide will the bike lanes be?
They are 4 feet. They're on both sides of the road. There's 2 bike lanes, one on each side. So basically you have a 4-foot shoulder that is going to be a bike lane. Typically a TDOT section will require you to be 6 or 8-foot shoulders, but here it was reduced down due to the constraints that we have existing out there. The next page you will see some various cross sections of what we were talking about as far as the different lanage configurations for Hillsborough Road. As you see, 300 feet south of Del Rio to just north of Independence Square is four lanes. These are 11-foot lanes except for, wait a minute, that's showing a five-lane section.
We do have a center turn lane at, just at the...
At the intersection.
At the intersection, that is correct.
What intersection?
Into Independence Square and also at Del Rio.
Del Rio,
this
yeah.
does start, this section that Dave was talking about starts south of Del Rio Pike, so we'll have a left turn lane there also. Oh.
Forgot about that. We do have half-turn lanes where some places where we have to have them in intersections. So anyway, that's basically the cross sections that we have there. You'll see the 4-foot bike lane. You have curb and gutter. Then you have a sod strip or brick strip between the curb and the sidewalk. It is a 5-foot sidewalk along the whole stretch of the roadway on both sides. So that is one of the design alterations we were able to obtain from TDOT is we do have the grass strip, although it's not our normal 6-foot grass strip that we usually try to get now. It is a grass strip which they typically do not do, as you'll notice out on 96 East when they built that section. The sidewalk's right behind the curb, so we don't like that. It's not, it's the pedestrians don't have a feeling of safety from the traveling public cars, so we've been able to get that grass strip in there. So,
did you say that there would be sidewalks all the way to?
There's sidewalks all along Hillsborough Road, yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. MacArthur.
Yes, ma'am. MacArthur has some sidewalks, but it's mainly a pedestrian pathway system all along MacArthur. So, or what's being newly built anyway. So. But that's where we are as far as the type laneage that we have. The next slide shows the schematic design of Hillsborough Road that was produced by EG&G for the trying to show what we're looking at. Then we go through various slides showing what the design is for Mac or Hillsborough Road, including the various elements of streetscape. You'll notice again you have the bike lane, you have street trees, you have sidewalks, you have a paver strip in the commercial area. You have brick walls that are in the areas where you have parking lots. You have the brick wall that will separate the roadway from the parking lot to hide the vehicles. The next sheet is, this first sheet is at 96 heading, then to the right is heading north. And then the second sheet gets you up to, from that point up to Mount Hope Street. Again, showing you the various elements. You have public utility drainage easements outside the right of way. And then at Folks, you will see brick walls at the radius there. That is your design elements for highlight, not necessarily strictly for the hiding of vehicles. You'll see a brick wall where we just purchased the property there. That's right where it says public utility drainage easement, right above the title of Hillsborough Road. That is the property we purchased and it has been torn down. That brick wall will not be built unless we actually go in and put a parking lot in that area. But right now we're thinking we will have to do some changes in that area to take some of that out. Then we pick up the next slide shows you from Mount Hope heading north up to Sharp's Branch Culvert. That is Sharp's Branch. It's not Sparks Branch. But this showing the elements that are included there. And then the next slide actually shows where the intersection of 3rd Avenue will come in. And it shows existing 4th Avenue. We'll point out that from centerline to centerline of 3rd Avenue proposed Third Avenue entrance into the hill, up to the hill, to the center line of Fourth Avenue is approximately 280 feet. So we're moving that intersection approximately 280 feet south, which will make this new intersection of Third Avenue approximately 1,000 feet south of Del Rio Pike intersection. I'm not sure how many of you really remember what we're trying to do with signalized intersections, in that we're trying to space signalized intersections of from 1,000 to 1,200 feet apart for being able to handle the traffic. This is getting us to about that minimum distance, but we couldn't go any further south because of the cemeteries. And this actually ends up being about 100 feet north of what would be center between North Margin and Del Rio. No, 96 and Del Rio, I'm sorry. That is Fourth Avenue, yes, ma'am.
Are you going to leave that?
No, it comes out. Okay. It will come out.
Are we going to wait and ask some questions? Because I've got some that I want to ask about this.
All right, next slide. The next slide just shows just puts in writing some of what I've been telling you. The generally three lanes, except in front of the high school, and then the commercial area is four lanes. We do have 11-foot lanes in commercial areas, not 12-foot lanes. Limits of construction from Highway 96 to Claude Yates Drive, and that's listed that way now because of the fact that Matt Catcher's coming down to Claude Yates Drive or thereabouts. It's approximately 6,000 linear feet. Then the next portion on this is showing you what the resolution 2009-22 directed as far as from the board at the time of what was approved. The installation of the irrigation system, landscape easements in commercial area, but not in the residential areas. Designating landscape easement documents that the property owner is responsible for maintenance of the landscaping, business signs, and other private property appurtenances within the easements. The city would be responsible for any sidewalk and curbing, brick screening wall, street lighting, irrigation elements in the landscape and access easements. That will reduce the city's maintenance as far as the landscaping and let the property owners handle that. But we would be doing the irrigation where there is irrigation. Again, the construction of brick screening walls where parking areas are visible from the roadway. That is an element that has been established as far as when we do the streetscape elements on our roadways. Design the traffic signals south of Del Rio with decorative poles and bases, and the north of Del Rio's alternates, the standard signal poles and decorative. Also be as an alternate to decorative bases for the signals north of and included Del Rio Pike. Again, this is trying not to make it all the same, but we did want the decorative that we have in the streetscape elements in the commercial area, just like we have on Columbia Avenue, Main Street, et cetera. And then we were going to do an alternate for seeing if we could get the bases for the signal poles at Del Rio as the decorative. If it's too expensive, we can eliminate that. So,
just one thing. We've talked about a little bit on not having alternates on Third Avenue and TDOT. It's very likely that we won't be able to bid alternates on this because of the money of the other portion of Hillsborough if we do bid this all as one big project. So I know that's what we're trying to do, but just letting you know, give you a heads up, it might not be done as alternates.
That's true. Forgot about that. And again, Hillsborough Road between Claude Yates and Matt Catcher is three-lane roadway tying to existing five-lane section. That has changed due to the Matt Catcher situation. This is when we were talking about whether we want to do seven or five lanes. And then the last issue was was decided at the time to acquire the properties at 302, 306, and 310 Fifth Avenue North in their entirety versus buying right-of-way and easements only. 306 is the one we have already acquired. 302 and 310 are on either side. So that's Hillsborough Road. The next slide is just a, to show you a page out of the Franklin Downtown Circulation Study. It has been asked about how we came up with a Third Avenue extension, et cetera. And this is where it shows or indicates Third Avenue extension and need as far as including it in the overall planning. I will tell you that before the circulation plan, we had already included the Third Avenue extension in our major thoroughfare plan. So it is a picks that up and then uses it as far as looking at the distribution of traffic as we try to take care of the traffic in the downtown area. As I had mentioned to you a month ago, there's also the improvement proposed for First Avenue tying into North Margin, as you'll see on the in the red line there. It didn't print very well, but you can see that on the right-hand side, upper right-hand side. That is First Avenue to North Margin. But we did want to just show that since that question had come up, we wanted to have that information before you also. The next slide shows Third Avenue extension. And what we've done here is we've tried to, we took the overall plan for Third Avenue by Centennial Park. We took off some of the elements that we know we could take off and that are in the park itself. But this is showing the various elements that are still included in some manner. You'll notice we do have brick sidewalks. We have stone veneer box culvert. We have the Belvedere wall in the Belvedere Park area. And we're also showing you the funding, some of the funding. You've got the STP-funded asphalt trail plus the STP-funded concrete trail. That is one of the grants that we have. And then we're showing you the TDEC-funded concrete trail also. Those are the funding grants that we have, the city has been able to obtain to help fund the project. Where you see the curve of Third Avenue headed over to Hillsborough Road, we have included in the design, I think we went over this before as far as explaining why, but I want to make sure everybody understands, we included the park elements in the design because, as you'll notice, there is very little room between Third Avenue and the river itself. And to do the roadway work and then come back later to do the park elements, we felt that we would be causing damages to what we'd already done, and we'd have to redo some of the elements of that we damaged trying to get the park work done. Now, at the Belvedere Park area, there is room to do work, but if you refer back to or remember back to the showing of Columbia Avenue or Hillsborough Road where you saw 3rd Avenue and 4th Avenue, we're taking out 4th Avenue, which has a bridge. We have to take that out. That's in that Belvedere Park area. So we have to do the work there anyway. And we have a lot of grading work that goes on there. We're saying the grading needs to be done as part of 3rd Avenue. Some of the other elements maybe could be done that wouldn't cause a great damage, but we have included them in the contract. That was when we were attempting to do alternate bids where if we could, we'd take it out. Of course, as we've explained, TDOT will not let us do alternate bids. So the work will be bid. If we want to eliminate something, we can go back and change order, not alternate, but we'd change order. The situation you have there is when you do alternate bids, you get a lot better pricing. When you go back and bid, when you bid something and go back for a change order, you typically do not get full value deducted for what you're deducting out of the contract. So that's the reason we like to try to do alternates. TDOT won't let us. Also, you'll see in this slide the cross section. I know it's hard to read, but there are the cross section for 3rd Avenue is 2 12-foot lanes, and then you have 8-foot parking areas, parking aisles on both sides. It's right here.
See it better on the screen now.
It's hard to see. Oh, yeah. Okay. Eric has zoomed in on it on the screen, so you can see it a lot better if you look at one of the screens. But you have the 8-foot parking on either side where you do have that parking, 12-foot lanes. And then it shows the elements of that you have with it also the street lighting, the sidewalks, The sidewalks, as I pointed out earlier, along Third Avenue are brick sidewalks to match what's been done on Third Avenue already. So that's what we have there. And what would the next slide is showing some of the elevations of Third Avenue that include the elements that are included in the project. It may be hard to see some of them, but it just sort of gives you an idea of what the look will be. Next, the first slide there shows you at the bridge itself, looking from Hillsborough Road back toward the park. You can see the Fourth Avenue overlook at the river. And then the next slide, you'll see closer detail of the Fourth Avenue overlook plus the monument type thing that's in the Belvedere Park area. There has been somebody, I think the last meeting we discussed Third Avenue, somebody asked about the steps down to the river. You'll see that in the lower left corner of this. You'll see it's a water steps down to the river. That is actually for aeration. It is a part of our quality stormwater elements for this project and the park project itself. But what it does, it's just like what you have at the wastewater plant. Mm-hmm. You have a step down, it flows over that. It allows air to be entrained into the water. So it's an aeration, an effort to put air back into the water, stormwater, as it enters into the river. So that is a stormwater issue. Then the next slide shows you the Belvedere Park area. The top is showing you from Hillsborough Road looking toward the park, the Fourth Avenue overlook. You'll see other overlooks. The other overlooks that you see in the background are not included in this project at this time. It would be in the park project when and if we get to that.
Which ones are you talking about there, point?
Eric's pointing to it right there. Those two back there that you see overlooks looking out over the river. The only one that's part of this project is the one that's closest to you there. The middle shows you the wall at the Belvedere Park. That is along Hillsborough Road. And then you look at, then you can see the Belvedere Park area looking south from, I guess basically where the walking trail starts now that goes into Chestnut Bend. But you'll see there's a lot of grading that's required there, and there's other elements involved. Then the next slide shows you the bridge. It is a stone veneered bridge. You'll notice there is a above sewer line that goes through the bridge. There's a gravity sewer that comes through there that we do have to maintain. We have to redo, but we'll have to maintain the gravity, and it requires us to be aerial there. So we have incorporated it under the bridge to hide it, basically is what it boils down to. You'll see that there are, can you zoom in on the railing? The railing is a special type of wrought iron railing. It's very decorative. A lot of these elements came out of the charrette efforts that were done for the Bicentennial Park, and looking at the park in this area and what we needed to do to enhance that situation. Then the next slide is just some verbiage concerning what we've been talking about. Third Avenue Extension is included in the Major Thoroughfare Plan as a planned improvement to a major collector street. The proposed improvements are extend Third Avenue around the city's cemeteries to intersect the Hillsborough Road across from the entrance to the city's services building. The cross section is two 12-foot lanes with sidewalk, street light, and other appurtenances, and there is parking in portions of it. This has been coordinated with the proposed Bicentennial Park. It was actually designed in conjunction with. Limits of construction are from North Margin to Hillsborough Road. It's approximately 1,300 linear feet. There will be 57 parking spaces. There will be irrigation in the right-of-way and park area. There are 24 streetlights, and there are 8 park lights included in the design of this project.
David, let me ask you or Eric to chime in on how this integrates with the Hillsborough Road project. To what extent does it, is it a companion to that project?
The Third Avenue is once we knew we had both projects that we were going to be looking at, we have contended that we need to try to keep the Third Avenue and the Hillsborough Road projects as close together for construction as possible, and as much as possible have Third Avenue first. And that is because we're changing that intersection of 4th Avenue to 3rd Avenue. We need to have that done, and to be able, as Hillsborough Road is being done, we need to have that done, and to be able to make sure it's done without going in and tearing out stuff again is we need to get 3rd Avenue either in conjunction with or before Hillsborough Road, if at all possible. So we've been working in that light from day one of when we knew we had both projects that were viable projects. So I think that's what you, Eric, were asking about. So
that would make sense.
Okay, then the next slide, we're through with Third Avenue at the moment. The next slide is the proposed priority for the present year, which was now going to be the future year. we've been talking in staff. It's really, we keep it listed 2011-2015 because that's where it started and that's where we are. But in actuality, it's going to be a 2012 priority type situation. This is what we presented to you in the handouts and accompanying information from the last meeting. Those projects or those funds that are highlighted in yellow are what we've identified are fundable in the funding plan. Don't correct me if I say anything wrong, Eric or Russ. And what we would ask, we're not asking for priorities or looking at going through and doing all these projects through construction. The yellow is what we're asking for being considered as a priority funding. You'll notice we do not have a priority ranking per se. We have 7 projects, I believe it is. We're looking at wanting to do the 7 projects as a priority by looking at the yellow, that's highlighted in yellow. And for the most part, that is the design for the various projects. As I mentioned before, for us to be able to look in the future at doing phasing on some of these projects, we have to have a design to know where we can do a phasing of the project itself for construction. So that's what we're looking at. Just go through the projects. The very top one is the Water Streets Fleet Maintenance Facility. This is looking at the possibility of buying the property on Columbia Avenue.
A property on Columbia Avenue.
Never mind, excuse me. But this is something that is looked at. It's trying to consolidate some of the public works facilities, get them together where, and it has a lot to do with the fleet maintenance activities that you have to, that you need. Solid waste is not included because you have a new solid waste facilities, et cetera. If you may recall, originally the fleet maintenance was going to be on that same property, but there's not enough property left for, or it's not configured correctly, actually, for being able to do a fleet maintenance facility on that property. So this would be the top project, or the first project listed. These are not listed in any particular order, other than I listed them based on how they appear in your big book of all the capital projects, just keeping them in order that they were listed there. So that's the only order that they're listed in. The second one is public safety of the fire stations number 7 and number 8. If you remember, number 7, fire station number 7 is that fire station that is proposed to be constructed in the Berry Farms subdivision area, Goose Creek. And then number 8 is the West Haven Fire Station. What we're asking for is funding for the design. We're trying to get a one design for all our fire stations. So we would be doing design for both of them. There will have to be some alterations for each design based on the property that we have, but generally the building itself, we're trying to get a standardized concept for the building for each, for all our fire stations. And the plan for this is that we will do a fire station configuration, and if there is any desire from a development to have additional or aesthetic looks beyond what we have designed, then they would pay for the differences.
Thank you.
So it would be, we would not have the situation that we had on the number 6 fire station. It would be, but the basic design we're looking at is similar to what number 6 is. It just doesn't have all the bells and whistles and aesthetics, exterior finishes, clock towers, that sort of thing. If a developer wanted that, then they would pay the difference to do that. The next project is the park at Harlandsdale Farm improvements. This was looking at mainly trying to get the main barn repaired, fixed, dried in, structurally sound, etc. And that's what that funding there was being looked at for. You'll notice we have an explanation for the priority below each project. That's the explanation that Eric, Russ, Vernon, and myself came up with of why we thought it was an important project in looking at trying to get done as quick as possible. The next project is the Central Court Beasley Drive connector. We feel this is a project needs to be done for the safety sake of the area to be able to get Beasley Drive people over to the signalized intersection at Century Court and Columbia Avenue. Almost all the right-of-way is acquired. We have one piece yet to do. The majority of the cost for this project is actually utility relocations, which is telephone and telephone electrical. There's big boxes back in the area that we've got to move. So that's what that project is. We do have, as you'll notice, we do have the whole project highlighted in yellow to where we can get it, to see if we can get it funded to get it completed. Then the next project is the McEwen Drive extension, Wilson Pike to Franklin's eastern city limits. This is the project that we have an agreement with Brentwood. We are in the process of trying to amend that agreement. We have had some discussion with Brentwood, and we haven't got it finalized. As soon as we have it finalized, staff level wise, we will bring it back. We will bring it to you for approval, and then Brentwood has to approve it, and then we have to get the court to approve it. But we hope to have this to you within the next meeting or two, the amendment to the contract or agreement with Brentwood for your consideration.
In general terms, what we're looking at is making it more driven by development than a specific date.
Right.
And that's conceptually what has been the understanding with Brentwood for some time, and we've put that into more specific language and are continuing to work on that at a staff level. And as David said, I think both bodies will be seeing it probably in the next month or so.
The other thing that we're making sure we have in there is that we're not building a four-lane section of roadway initially. We're making sure that it does say that we're planning on building two lanes initially, designed for four, build two. So we've kind of prioritized or phased that project already.
Any questions about that, Kat?
Yeah. The next project is McEwen Drive at Wilson Pike intersection improvements. Reason we have this here is we're looking at needing to get some additional funding, about $450,000 additional funding over the $2 million that we already have approved. As I said earlier, we have $1 million from the school board, the county, and $1 million from the city. We're trying to look at doing an initial improvement. It's not an ultimate improvement of the bridge crossing the railroad, but initial improvement that will buy us more time. But it will also provide for better traffic control at the intersection itself. So And to do that, we're looking at estimates. We've been working with our consultant, and we feel we're going to need about $450,000 more dollars to be able to do that, to make it a viable, more viable project other than just going out there and getting an intersection built. And we think that what we're proposing to do here will allow us to have not to have to increase or do any additional work at the intersection other than the McEwen Drive east of Wilson Pike tie-in, but we would not have to go back and do the bridge work, any more bridge work on the railroad for about 10, 15, 20 years, depending on how fast development happens. So we're trying to buy us more time before we have to go back and do additional work. The next project is McEwen Drive Phase 4. That's from Cool Springs Boulevard to Wilson Pike. This is to finish the design. And once we get the design completed, then we can start looking at how we may want to phase it. As you can see, it is a very expensive project. We're going over that hill. We've got a lot of cut, a lot of blasting, a lot of work to be done. But we're looking at trying to get the design done where we can go, then come back to you and look at some reasonable phasing of the project that makes it more affordable. We do not feel that we need to build a four-lane section. It is to be a four-lane section. It will be designed as a four-lane section, but we feel they'll only need four lanes just coming away from the roundabout for a short distance and then start into a two-lane section that will provide what we need. We will probably be recommend that we go and put the bike lanes and all in as we do the two-lane section. So then the next project is the South Carruthers Parkway extension, Falcon Creek to Harpeth River. This actually, the $3.5 million is actually looking, we have that project designed, I'm sorry. That the project as described, the limits as described, is designed. The $3.5 million is being proposed where we can do a two-lane section from where the curve is at Falcon Creek down to the southern boundaries of the proposed Nichols Bend subdivision, and then tie in South Carruthers at that southern boundary. So it would be a two-lane section. It would be great. A lot of the grading would be done for four-lane because we have an agreement with Nichols Bend that we get borrow material from their subdivision for the subgrade and grading of the roadway. So we need to go in and get that before they start developing. So we'd be doing grading, more of the grading for four-lane, but we would only build the two-lane, which would be the eastern or ultimate northbound two lanes, which is the side that the development itself is going to be on. The other side is going to be end up being open space, or I think they're actually trying to get the city to take it as park. So, but anyway, that's the proposal there. Then we have listed below this, Carlisle Lane, Board Mill Avenue at Highway 96 West signalization. That is, we put this in as an alternate should something, and probably would be the Water Street Fleet Maintenance Facility is probably the only project that would be enough money to go on and fund this should you decide not to do it. So this is being listed as an alternate should you decide not to do like that first project we mentioned.
Or if there are other opportunities that create a funding opportunity, this would be kind of the next best place to look to complete that project. Let me just comment real quick overall. What we tried to do and what's in your packet is the priorities we received and that we ask each of the department directors to do that had lead responsibilities in the areas of transportation, parks, et cetera. What we tried to do is look at sort of a balanced way forward that advanced significant projects, also took care of other ones that were areas of need, tried to also balance operational needs for the city organization long term with being ready to phase in major transportation needs as well, so that we kind of balance all of those needs as we go forward. This is in total just over $10 million worth of projects, some funded through hotel motel tax, some with a bit of facility tax funding, the rest drawing on your overall general capital program and funding as we'd envisioned it previously. So I think that's what we try to do is strike a balance among those areas and advance projects that we thought had a, a significant positive impact, be ready to go in other areas. You'll see in its entirety, McEwen was now designed entirely through this this process, and then we're ready to start looking at phasing and being opportunistic in getting that implemented over time. We advance the consolidation of our public works functions into one location, and we're looking at opportunities to do that so we can be more efficient, have more capacity long term in those areas, get out of antiquated facilities that really don't meet our needs even today, and much less looking 10, 15, 20 years down the line. We move the ball forward in terms of being ready to do fire stations as those opportunities come forward as well. So I think we've tried to strike a good balance here to move a number of areas forward to deliver specific projects as well as be ready for opportunities and phasing and as we go forward as well.
Okay, the next slide is looking at funding, and I'm going to quit talking for a moment and let Eric and Russ take over.
I handed out a sheet to you that didn't make it in here that is the original funding plan, what we called Scenario 7 back in September of 2009, I guess it was. And that is really what was identified to be funded at that time. And this is how we looked at those projects and the totals that we put with those projects. I sort of added that project total column to the far right that was not there previously. But that gives you an idea of what we worked from when we developed the funding plan, and the funding plan that the board approved then and that we've been working on since then. The next page that's in the handout that you had is something Russ kind of pulled together that shows what was in that plan and what's actually been expended to this point on those projects, and sort of compares those as well. And of course, that funding plan didn't incorporate what we did in the small project realm. We'll kind of get to how we fold that in a minute. Russ, I don't know if you want to take a minute to sort of walk through what that sheet shows, folks, just to give you some context of the projects and where they are.
This is a variety of information that's been asked for at one time or another. It really doesn't correlate terribly well, and it's a little confusing if you try to use the columns to add it together. But for example, under Hillsborough Road, you see what the 2010, 2011, and 2012 forecast was under the original. Those are the black lettering. It adds up to $24.5 million. We went back and took the bond use summary that we've provided over the last several weeks to come up with the amount that's actually been spent, just to kind of let you know where we are. And that's almost $2.6 million that we've either spent or contracted through December 31st. We'll have an update on that for you in a couple of weeks that'll go through the end of March. But that kind of tells you what we've spent so far. And then I took the liberty that with the blue numbering to give you what a revised schedule really looks like if we move forward, to give you a feeling for what those numbers look like. And if you go down the project totals and add them all together, what you'll see is, you know, what we originally thought, well, all the projects would be about $74 million. And that would be what we would need. The borrowing requirements, as we look at them right now with the current numbers, has come down to about 59. And that's approximately what we've borrowed, if you remember. We had one issue with $44 million, and then we had another issue that had the very low interest rate on it that was in the $16 million range. So we're in the vicinity of where we said we would be over that five-year period.
I need to ask a question here, but isn't some of that we borrowed, wasn't it repaying things that we had already expended? So it's really not including the extra money on Hillsborough?
Well, if you notice, right before the last project total, there's $27 million in committed projects. So that's really folded into this.
And we were carrying that when we did the funding plan as well.
Absolutely.
So that's a consistent number between where you were in 09 and where you are now.
But really, the $59 million that we've already borrowed really included that $27 million, didn't it?
It absolutely did.
Okay.
It did.
Okay.
What I tried to do was to give you the most updated information we had in a format that looked very similar to the plan that we adopted in, if I remember right, September of '09, approximately. The other line item that I put at the bottom, just as a reference point, not to make a point, but to make sure that you're aware of it, this is the scheduled reduction in principal that we have in our annual debt service. So in 2010, we paid off $4.6 million. This year, we'll pay off almost $6 million. 2012, we have scheduled $6.3 million. So every year, we're reducing this amount and creating some capacity. If you would be satisfied with the debt staying at the level it is today, we're just by having time passed and paying this off, we're creating about $5 to $6 million in capacity each year. So I want you to see that and have that in the back of your mind as you look at these projects.
One of the things that, if you turn to the next page, the last page in the packet, and this really is a good companion with the sheet I handed out to you. That's the original funding plan. And it might be a good idea to kind of put them right next to each other, because this is this with the yellow band at the top talks about changes in amount. This really takes that funding plan and says, okay, what's different in that from a capacity standpoint? And the first group is areas where we generated some project savings. Should be in the last page of the whole packet. Right there. There you go. Want to make sure you see it. And so there's a list of what we identified first in July of 2010, and then we've worked to update that number with some other information that we have now. And I will note some of them include where we are with bid award, and so they're not 100% project completed savings, but they give you a sense of the kind of capacity that maybe have been freed up in what we estimated in that funding plan and to where we are today. And I'll just go through real quickly the Royal Oaks intersection project that was completed now about a year and a half ago. That was about $900,000. We had some underspending on the police headquarters as well. These were all things that we anticipated borrowing for that have come in under. We've got, and then some additional money on Royal Oaks, you'll also see there. McEwen, we've got listed two different places as we had some savings identified previously, and then we take what's totally been borrowed in McEwen versus expenditures that happened pre-bid for design, et cetera, as well as the current bid that was awarded a couple months ago, along with $100,000 in contingency that we're working towards that I think we have put before you now to consider. So that gives you a bid with a little bit of contingency on it, and that shows about $3.87 million compared to what we had in that funding plan to where we are today with a bid awarded and the project underway. The small project allocation, as you remember, we took 5 years and we allocated $500,000 a year to try to pick off smaller projects. We really only allocated $500,000 of that. And you'll see that kind of in the next line, which is the Mowry Station General George Patton Signal project. And that was originally estimated at just above $500,000. It came in well below that. And I don't think I've captured the $140,000 that Verizon put into that project. So that number is actually probably a little bit better in that I think they were putting in about $140,000 of funding towards that project as well. But that's the bid award that we did earlier this year as well. As you all remember, the Goose Creek Interchange, we pulled our participation in converting that to a single point intersection to now the more traditional diamond design, which is now fully funded by TDOT. We did have a little bit of reimbursement we needed to provide to TDOT for that, so that's allocated here as well. Now, we have had a few other places where we've had to add money to projects to work things through or have allocated savings to a project. There was an initial additional funding for some of the streetscape projects that we'd done. Nickel Mill, as you remember, was not originally funded. When we went through the small project process, that did come up as a longstanding commitment of the city. We moved forward with that. We did add some additional funding to that project a month or so ago. That's reflected in this number as well. So this is the current awarded contract cost, estimated cost for the Nickel Mill improvements. And then added in, if you look at that funding plan, when we originally did Third Avenue North, we had a $3.1 million allocation for the roadway project. We have since updated that when we did our capital investment projects out to you earlier this year, and that is now in the neighborhood of $5.1 million. I will say, though, I've netted out in the number here, there's a $740,000 grant that we're using for the trails that is incorporated in the Third Avenue project. So I've netted that out for the purpose of us seeing capacity here. So that's $740,000 that's taken out of that $5.138 million that was in the capital investment plan as we have it now. But when you did the funding plan, you did it at $3.138 million. Okay, I just want to be clear on that. We had had a number that I think was more of a standard takeoff on roadway costs, and we updated it with our knowledge of the project and all the elements in it when we updated those numbers earlier this year when you got the capital project update. So I went ahead and put that in there because it is a project that's here, but I wanted to be clear that the numbers we're carrying now are more in the $5.1 million as opposed to that $3.1 million based on our estimates for completing the project. And then Columbia Avenue, when we've gotten near completion there, there have been some additional costs, I think largely associated with some of the property acquisition. So that's a little bit above what that contract award was originally at. So that's about $150,000. So in total, those additions are about $3.1 million. The project savings above were about $13.1 million. We had calculated, and this is just carrying over the numbers we calculated last July, based on the borrowings that we had done, the debt that we had issued, and the assumptions we made in that funding plan, we identified just under $2.9 million in assumed financing costs that did not come to fruition when we actually did those borrowings.
Over how many years?
Over the life of the
Not those, over the 5 years.
Yeah, when we looked at that.
It is a net present value.
It's a net present value, I'm sorry. Okay. So that is a net present value that Russ calculated when we looked at those in July. And so I just carried that number forward. And so in total, when we compare what we approved in the funding plan and what we've actually done over the last year and a half, moving a number of projects forward and projects that were already in the pipeline, there's a capacity of just under $13 million that I would say if you're comfortable with the funding plan you adopted previously, that you would have to potentially work with. And what we've identified in our capital investment package that staff has recommended to you is about $10 million worth of projects and design. And so that, I think, puts that in context for you. And that had been helpful to the board when we looked at things at mid-year about a year ago. And so wanted to update that with more current information. I don't know if there's anything else to add to that. Otherwise, we'll open it up to questions and discussion further. But thank you for giving us the time to kind of walk through all of it. So.
Alderman Skinner.
We briefly touched on Eastern Battlefield Road. We're kind of in a strange situation here. We've applied for a grant from the state, and you know, it's going to be worth almost $1 million if we get the grant. But if we don't get the grant, remember this was the number one priority in small projects last year. So somehow we need not to forget that there was a commitment for that. And barring loss of this grant money, we need to reserve at least enough that the state was going to offer for us to complete this project before we commit to other things but before we finish this. So,
and I'd comment on that too. One of the things we did is, from a staff perspective, we don't think there's enough funding there to do what the board had envisioned. If we just look at this $369,000 that was allocated from hotel motel tax funding. And we started to have that discussion, but also have heard that we're probably gonna get word one way or another on the grant funding soon. So that would have some impact on how much we need to go back to our own funding, what we need to do, or if that grant changes that discussion. So I think we're gonna get some some information on that in the next few weeks, so hopefully that will help us. But Alderman Skinner makes a great point. We have to bear that in mind, because I don't think we can get done what was originally envisioned at this number. If we don't get the grant, we're going to need to return to that and re-examine it. The discussion staff was prepared to have with you was to look at maybe some more specific direction on design and what we do, so that we know exactly what we want to fund, because part of this was we were sort of looking at some options and how this might work, and the more we can focus in on that, the more we can specifically, I think, strategize about getting that project done and getting you a specific number to work towards.
I was going to piggyback on that, if that's okay. What money are we talking about that would be needed? I mean, ballpark. I don't mean an extra 100,000, an extra million. What?
Well, it really depends on what is decided to be constructed. If you go the full loop road, it's
1.6 million.
Yeah, 1.6 million. If you go just the half to tie into existing asphalt, you're talking about, I think it was almost 700 total.
So it would
like
still
that.
Be kind of double what we
yes.
we had
yes.
committed.
I think that might be a good
as a minimum cost.
Number.
I think you're looking at double, maybe a little more than double of what's been committed at this point.
Does that include the design, or is that
yes?
Yeah, that's part of the design.
Yes.
And that would help us with the design costs, too. The more focused the design, the less we have to spend on doing options. So
right.
if we can get that narrowed down, that helps us with cost, too, project cost, too.
But speaking of the grant, if the grant is approved as been proposed, what we have allocated for funding looks like it will cover the local match.
Oh, okay.
So
it would be a matching.
A pretty good I think it's a 80-20 match, I believe, is what it would be. So we're looking, if that comes through, we're in real good shape.
And that's for the loop road?
No, it would be the two-way.
Two-way road.
Essentially up to the Fleming Center and connecting the club.
But it also includes the parking lot, which our almost $700,000 does not include the parking lot. For the Fleming Center, that parking lot there at the Fleming Center.
Yeah, I'd just like to add that I was in a meeting last week, and the Franklin Battlefield Trust, now not our commission that's part of the city, but the trust, they're making plans for the 2014 150th anniversary of the Battle of Franklin. And right now their plans are to use the Eastern Flank Battlefield. So the danger is, if we don't somehow get into this and get it finished, we may lose a real tourist opportunity in 2014 if the Eastern Plank Battlefield is still incomplete.
So time frame is key there.
Well,
I think in the reverse, they need to understand the same situation though.
And sure. Once the funding is approved or we get the grant, what is our time frame to be able to construct?
Good question.
It shouldn't be a long time to.
We could meet the 2014 time frame, but to give you a time frame right now, I don't think we could. We have to finish design, ready for bid, but the actual construction would be less than a year.
Mm-hmm. 6 months.
Unless we had weather like we're having right now, then it could change.
It depends on how much is involved, but because there's no traffic going to be on it, that helps.
Right.
It's our property.
Right.
We don't have easements.
Why can't you go out with the design, finish the design now, with what you've got?
We don't have funding for the design approved.
So what are you want to approve it?
We'd like to get the direction. If we can get the answer on the grant, then we know what we're working on.
Do you know what to design for?
We think that answer is fairly close at hand, so it'd be better to know that and then design accordingly.
What's close at hand mean?
2 months.
It could be a month. It could be 6 months. Right?
I'd say within a month.
Several days, and that meant 2 to 20.
Yeah, it's not 6 months.
Okay.
It's sooner than that.
I mean, I'm serious.
And let me just say, the other thing, my understanding is the funds would be available as quickly as June. I mean, that's how it works. It's on a cycle of around June each year that they do the allocation. It's a governor sign-off So it's not just through TDOT only, it's TDOT through the governor, and the governor ultimately makes that decision on these funds.
Alderman Bransford.
I just want to applaud the staff, you guys, for putting together this packet. It's really give us, me, a focus, I can narrow, I can give some thought and to something that that you all have given great consideration to and deliberation. And I think that's what, you know, you get the big bucks for. And I just like having this tool.
Yeah, I was going to pull my wallet out. I don't think I got big bucks there.
So, even though there's probably questions, I'm not prepared for all of them right now, but I do have something that I can move forward with, and I appreciate the time and the energy and the thought you put into this.
I have a couple of questions. I'm trying to find them. One of the things on here is I hope we get a decent agreement with Brentwood so we don't have a problem of putting the cart before the horse over there on McEwen, because no way should McEwen from Wilson Pike to the eastern city limits be done before McEwen Phase 4 from Cool Springs, Oxford Glen down to Wilson Pike. Just want to say that up front, because that is you know, not even in the ballpark compared to what we're dealing with over there on Phase 4.
I will say, Ms. Berger, as far as the way the draft is now, it is more development-driven.
Exactly.
You mentioned that.
And I think I would say the conversations I've had with Brentwood, too, is they are encouraged that we're moving forward on McEwen 3. I mean, that just shows that we are, we're making progress. And so I think that helped with that issue when we originally approached them on it over a year ago, and we're getting to the point where we're trying to bring that down to specifics now.
And also, I think it's much more attractive if Phase 4 would get started, we get the design, we get the right-of-way, and we'd get that started, then that is more attractive to the people for development over there for the other Phase 5, I guess it is, isn't it?
So we're not calling it.
Yeah,
trying to get away from that phase number.
Whatever. And then the other thing is, you mentioned about the standard design for the fire stations. So could we not take the design that we have, the interior design, for that Fire Station 6, for Fire Station 7 and 8?
Yeah, it's a good start for it.
I mean,
it's a good start, but there's with the way it was built, there are things that have to be definitely changed on it. And then we've got to look at also, does it meet the needs that we need for our fire stations? After they've been in it a while, they'll be able, the fire department will be able to tell us that in a more concise manner. So make sure we meet the needs of the fire station with that, but we'll have to alter the design.
I've got one more question. About the fire station?
Yeah, but you go on, finish yours.
All right. Well, if it's the fire station, jump in. Do you want?
Well, I just don't
understand. It's on the fire station.
On the fire station, 7 and 8.
Yes, ma'am.
Why would you build Berry Farms before you built West Haven?
Good question.
Yeah. Since West Haven's already there and Berry Farms isn't.
The thought is right now that we would build West Haven first.
Oh.
Berry Farms is number 7. That's just the way the fire department.
They're numbered that way.
That's the way they have them numbered as far as when they looked at it. But the thought right now is that West Haven would be first. In fact, we're looking at needing to get started on West Haven as quick as we can.
My last question on Phase 4. You have the numbers here, the $17,792,000. Does that $17 million address the cost of 4 lanes or 2 lanes here?
4.
That's 4. So
that would bring your cost down.
Exactly, because it was.
That is looking at a 4-lane section based on dollars several years back.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, you know, it's.
Well, it was
we think it would cover like a 4-lane, but again, it's got to keep remembering that they're old numbers.
Right, but it was my understanding too that $17 million covered 4 lanes. So
yes,
yeah. Which we need to get the right of way and the design for 4 lanes, but we need to build it too. So
well, that's the concern we have is the right of way, the construction's gone down right away, even though we're in economic times, the right-of-way seems to have gone up still tremendously.
I just have one more question about the way we totaled the, you included two million in small project allocation, that's over the next, for a four-year period, but we're not actually, are we reserving that amount? So that's really not available for maybe larger projects, or how
does that fit in?
It's a capacity that you have available to you that was in that funding plan. We can choose to do an annual exercise, or we can identify things that are small projects like Beasley that's here. Those are all kind of things for you to look at. Quite honestly, I'm not sure that the small project discussion worked, was as productive as we might have wanted it to be. We spent a lot of time on...
Well, small projects tended to move to big projects, so we need to consider what the dollar amount is on a small project.
And that's part of why our mindset shifted to kind of a package of projects that touch on the whole of city operations and larger projects, and getting larger projects ready, but also taking care of some smaller projects and some things we need to do to be ready. So that was why we looked at it that way, but it was really more of a statement of the capacity that's in there.
Alderman.
Every one of these things that you went over, I think are wonderful, and I would like to see every single one of them done. But I do think the signal at Carlisle in 96 is extremely important, and I see what it's going to cost, and I just don't know if we need to do a Cadillac version. I know you mentioned that you really designed that to be a wonderful intersection, but all they want is a light. And why can't you just do a Chevrolet version?
What you're talking about would be
more
like a Pinto.
Light is light.
We first started, as I explained to you, Ms. Martin, when we first started this, we were looking at trying to do signalization only. Then we got to looking at, we have alignment problems with Carlisle, Boyd Mill, Avenue, et cetera. To put a signal up and have offsets in the alignments, et cetera, you're actually creating hazard. So... if we go into it, we need to take care of it in a safe manner. So that sort of precipitated doing a little bit more than what we originally thought we would get into, and then we have other issues that have come up from
I know the
decisions and all that
right of way and all that stuff. But really, all they want is a signal, and I just wish that there was some way you could cut this so that you could do this and all these other things too.
Really, the biggest thing that you could really cut, like what you're talking about, is maybe going from the mast arms to the span wire, which is not our typical design.
It's a string.
Yeah, I mean, that's one possibility. But the alignment, if you don't do the alignment, all you're doing is you're gonna have cars that stop there. If you don't have a turn line, if you don't have the alignment fixed, you can't have a turn line. You don't have a turn line, you just got, anytime one person wants to turn, it just backs it up.
Is there any West Haven money in this?
No, sir.
Project?
Well, let me go through that since it has come up several times. At one point, there was discussion as to moving $200,000 committed from West Haven for the intersection of 96 and Hillsborough Road to Carlisle Lane signalization. Staff recommended against that and recommended that when I say you in this case, I'm talking about board, whatever board it was at the time. If we wanted to look at trying to get some funding for Carlisle, we needed to look at doing both. Both intersections require funding. It did not get approved that way, so it was not changed. So there is $200,000 committed from West Haven for the intersection of 96 and Hillsborough Road, which we will be looking at trying to collect for that work. But there is none that has been committed or required for the Carlisle Lane intersection.
There's a small amount, I think it's $30,000, from Cornerstone, but nothing from West Haven.
Back several years ago, we granted some concessions to West Haven, and I thought they made $1 million commitment at some point in time back to the city.
And West Haven made a $1.25 million commitment for MacHatcher. We have actually invoiced them. They came back and asked for a delay in payment of it. It is for, actually it was set up for when the design was being done, to help pay for the design. They came back and asked for a delay in payment due to economic times. I don't know how formally that all was, but if my understanding is correct, that the city, informally at least, has granted that request, I guess, several years ago, if I remember correctly. But there is a commitment out there.
To delay the
commitment. There has been a commitment. I will tell you that it was a commitment made in public meeting. It is on tape. We do not have a signed agreement that we can find. There is an agreement that it was drafted at one time, but it's never been signed that we can find. So, but there was a commitment of $1.25 million.
Was it made at the Board of Mayor, not that it matters if there's no signed commitment, was it made at the Planning Commission or the Board of Mayor and Alderman?
It was actually a committee. I think it was
Planning
the old transportation committee.
I think it's still binding, regardless. It was a commitment. They got concessions.
Yes.
So, yes.
Got one last question.
Well, if I just have one question, I've got a big one that I think.
One last questioner, how's that? I think we'll finish up a little early.
Well, first of all, let me say this is extremely helpful and has a lot of the parts that I'm very interested in. There, you know, now that I've seen all of this, there are many questions that I'd like to ask throughout all of this, and we do need to have some more time to talk about it. This was great to get it rolled out this way. Just since our time is not really long right here, I thought that, you know, just looking at some the big numbers here, first of all, if you notice what the commitment was, that sheet that was handed out last, it also stated taking $5 million out of the fund balance. So that part right there is, you know, means that we still need to take $5 million out of the fund balance if we're going to account this way, if we're going to designate this way. And another thing on the savings, the savings plan, mm-hmm. here, it states that we have $2 million in the small project allocation, but I thought it says over here that we have already allocated in the small projects. Well, first of all, we had the road, the park road out there, and secondly, the other another small project that we had counted on, that we had, I thought, funded, wound up being the $1.9 million or whatever it is.
What you did is you allocated, when we did the small project funding, mm-hmm. we allocated some other funds to get some other projects moving. The only small project money you allocated was $510,000 towards the Mallory Station General George Patton signal. The other funding was a allocation of savings to move forward with Nickel Mill. And the improvements there, and the other was an allocation of hotel motel dollars to the eastern flank access road.
Okay,
so while we had it in the context of that small project discussion, we only allocated really 1 year's worth of funding, and when it came in at bid, it actually came in at almost half that amount at
$158,000. Could I go back
sure.
before we move from that? Mm-hmm. If you're talking about allocation of savings, doesn't that take some of those numbers, though, that you have right here?
It's in there.
I was fixing to explain that. If you look in this sheet, you see $900,000
right.
saved
right.
from Royal Oaks. It was well over $1 million saved from Royal Oaks, and there was $300,000 saved from the intersection of McEwen and Cool Springs Boulevard. That is what makes up the money down here for Nickel Mill
okay.
improvements is the
okay.
1.58. We took those monies to make up. So the Royal Oaks, actually, savings was well over $1 million, but there's only $900,000 of it, quote, left because you used part of it for the nickel mill.
And there is a second shot in there of $109,000, but it's at least $1 million that we've got in here. There's probably a little more. But we did allocate the funding for nickel mill in here, and that number, that calculates out to that bottom line of just under $13 million.
Okay, but you're saying then that even though we talked about this in the small projects, it really wasn't a small project. It was designated down in this other thing.
Yeah, because at the time, I think we showed you around $8 or $9 million worth of savings. That's when this sheet was originally generated.
Yeah, exactly.
And it was around $8 million. And I think at that point, the board felt comfortable allocating about $1.5 million of it. I think we thought it was going to be a little less than that at the time.
Right,
but
right.
To that project. And this number reflects the current cost of the project.
And the resolution that was approved July 13th has that spelled out of where the funding is.
Now that July 13th of 2010.
Yeah.
2010, yes, there. Okay, as I say, I really like this a lot. It's worthy to look through. I definitely don't want to get away from the first part of what was done, though, looking at Hillsboro, because, you know, for one thing, as planned now, we're going to have a traffic light at the Third Avenue, and really it goes to a driveway, basically, instead of being a through street there.
It provides access to that hill property.
Exactly.
As well as to Sonic.
That's right.
So how are you going to get the traffic out of Third Avenue if you don't have a light?
Well, the other thing I want to, you know, that we've been talking about is that we need to look and see what the traffic is there, because I have been going that way all the time, and I just want to see what those numbers are. And right now, there's no problem getting out of where margin comes in right now, you know. But still, as I say, this was really great to get us. But again, since we just got it and we just saw it today, we really need to have some time to kind of digest.
Sure, and we'll bring it back. And
yes.
I'd make one comment about the signalization there, is that that's going to make that hill property where the current facility is probably much more valuable, because people be able to get in and out. But go ahead.
And Mayor, it gives you a shot from Hillsboro Road to I-65, one road. When you come Third Avenue, like we've got it designed here, and you signalize on Hillsboro Road, you've got one road to go all the way to 96, to all the way out 96, all the way to 65 then. So I see it as a traffic improvement.
And you've got it. Don't we
have 96 going through on Bridge Street right now?
We've got to get it off Bridge Street.
You meant east, right?
If you come back now and you signalize that intersection there, you've got Third Avenue, one road coming all the way through town, going out 96, going out to the interstate. You've got one road going all the way.
I know what you're talking about. I know what you're talking about.
Instead of
gerrymandering through.
Right.
All right, we'll come back.
Okay, we need to talk about these. This was great.
Good. Y'all did a good job.
Thanks.
Right. That was wonderful.
Good work.